invites and encourages all who are seeking a community to empower, support, and explore deeper understanding of spirituality and recovery of all kinds. We join together with our family and loved ones in our journey to enlightenment and recovery, and supporting one another spiritually without judgment or prejudice.
Say hello to my neighbor, greet him with a smile, shake the hand of a stranger, sit and talk for a while, tell someone I love them from the bottom of my heart. Today I'm gonna try and change the world. Take it one day at a time. I've made my resolution. I've opened up my eyes. Today I'm gonna try and change the world. I'm gonna make sure my children know there's a right from wrong. Never turn my back on those of us who need someone. I'm gonna try to see myself through another's eyes. Today I'm gonna try and change the world. Yeah, today I'm gonna try and change the world. Gonna take it one day at a time. I've made my resolution. I've opened up my eyes. Today I'm gonna try and change the world. Yeah, today I'm gonna try and change my world. Gonna take it one day at a time. 'Cause I've made my resolution. I've opened up my eyes. Today I'm gonna try and change my world. Yeah, today I'm gonna try and change my world. Yeah, today I'm gonna try and change the world.
Thank you, Jody. Oh, okay, pull myself together for a minute. That one was really... My name is Becky R., and I would like to share with you the spiritual principle of change. And it's really amazing as I'm listening to this beautiful song that it's only six letters. And it's so big, you know. So what is it and how does it relate to us, right? What does it mean for us? Well, the definition of change is to make different in some particular, you know, to alter it or to make radically different is to transform it. So change can be just an alteration. Let's move the furniture to the other room, or a transformation. Let's get new furniture, right? To give a different position, course, or direction to. And for a lot of us, and this isn't something that I knew coming into recovery, but for a lot of us, we don't really understand and didn't fathom in the beginning that change is really the only constant thing there is. Everything changes. Our bodies change. You know, what they say, we resell ourselves every 6 weeks, and I mean certain cells within just a month regenerate. So it is really the only factor. Everybody's like, oh, I don't want things to change. However, everything is changing. It is Mahatma Gandhi that says, one of his most famous quotes that I've held on to for a long time is to be the change you wish to see in the world. And that's what Jody Song was talking about. If I want my neighbor to be friendly, then I can be friendly to my neighbor. I read a book a long time ago, and if you have this on your shelf, it's hilarious. It's the author, Charlotte Castle, is amazing. She's been in recovery for a long time. She writes a lot of different books, but this one was called If the Buddha Dated. And this was, I don't know, I guess I had been single for about 4 or 5 years when I started reading this book, and without a relationship for me, especially growing up through my life, without a partner, was a big deal, because I was like deliberately set out to make sure my life was going to be different, because everything up until that point, I had only been the only common denominator in any relationship I had had. I was the only common. So if the same results were happening, I needed something to change. So I picked up this book, and it was very enlightening. She's got a whole series on them if you get a chance to ever look at it. But she's got this one particular part in this book where she says, and if you're my age, you're going to remember this. The personal ads used to say things like SWF in search, ISO. You know, you guys think that the kids can text now? We did this way back, because words cost money in the newspaper. So we shortened it, you know, single white females in search of single male, you know, we coded all these messages so we could search for the right person and have them answer the ad. And then the next week we'd pull up the newspaper and see if somebody had answered our ad, right? Well, Charlotte in her book tells you to write a page long what you're searching for. What do I want in this person and in this relationship? You write it all out. I mean, just in complete detail, you go through this practice, which was really amazing when she got down to the end of this. So she has you all write it all the way out, and then she tells you, and you know, you're thinking, oh gosh, you know, this would be the really long ad in the newspaper, which nobody can afford. So she says, bring it down to 10 words. I'm like, 10 words? Okay, hold on. So you have to go through and see, really find out what you're looking for. Do you really want someone that's compassionate? Do you really want somebody that's sincere? Do you want somebody that you really care if they're single or not? I mean, you really have to break this down to what it is you want. And in the end, this whole practice, which was one of the lessons in it, she says, now you've got your 10 words. Now go out and be that. And I felt tricked, because I didn't know that that's where she was headed. That all these things, this list of things that I wanted for my life and in my life and in this person that I was searching for, I had to be that in order to attract it. Now, about the same time that this happened, I started attending my first Unity Church, and it was in Memphis, Tennessee, and I actually got to meet Mahatma Gandhi's grandson. One of his grandsons, the one that was living here in the United States. And he tells a story about his grandfather. And one of the stories is this woman comes to bring her son to see Gandhi, and she's like, he's got a sugar addiction, you know, I'm paraphrasing here, okay, I'm sure he doesn't talk like that, or he didn't talk like that, but, you know, he's got a sugar addiction, I can't get him to stop eating sugar, what am I doing? And Gandhi listened to everything she had to say, and he was very compassionate and understanding, and, you know, and in the end of the session, he told her, take him home and bring him back in 2 weeks. And she was kind of like, okay, well, all right, I'll do that. And so she takes him home, and she lives with this addiction, you know, this sugar addiction that her son has. And she's like, brings him back. She's even more frustrated than she was the first time. And she brings him back in, and Gandhi sits down with him, and she, you know, she asks how the last 2 weeks have went. She says, it's the same thing. He's doing the same thing. I can't get him to stop eating sugar. I know this is going to cause problems. And he says, now, you have to stop eating sugar. You can have no sugar in anything. He tells the boy this, right? And because it's Mahatma Gandhi, he's like, oh, yeah, I'll listen to you. It was just grandma before or mom before, you know, I'm not going to listen to them, but Mahatma Gandhi, yeah, okay, I'll listen to you. So the boy goes home with his, they start to head out with his mother, and his mother gets him outside, and she turns around and she goes, why didn't you tell him that last week, 2 weeks ago when I was here? And Gandhi said, because I hadn't quit eating sugar yet. And he says, well, I have to, you know, he was such a consistent person that he knew that inside himself he had to be that change. You know, so he couldn't ask somebody something of somebody else if he wasn't willing to give it himself. So we need to be the change. We need to model it. We need to live it. And we need to reflect it into our world, right? How do we work? How do we become the change? Sounds like it's simple, right? Well, that depends on how deep you want the change to be. I can tell you that it's simple, although it's not always easy. And we know this being in recovery. We know this is if your first day or if it's your 50th year of being in recovery, because cravings can come from nowhere. We can be triggered by anything. We can reach a point where we're in the middle of our day, everything's going wrong, and a scent can throw us off. And then we don't know. We've spiraled out of control and trying to figure out what's going on. Most of the time, I don't really even care about drinking anymore. But that's, I said most of the time. That doesn't mean all of the time. That doesn't mean that I can't place myself in a slippery slope and realize that, oh gosh, this is just too, I'm too close to the edge here. I want to be careful, right? So we have to choose for ourselves what changes we want to change in our lives. And that's a very individual process. So I'm not going to even stand up here and try to pretend like what I would even know what would go on for someone else's life. I know what worked in mine. We have to know ourselves to do this. And if we don't write that ad and narrow that down and figure out what it is. When I first started in recovery, I didn't know what play was. Seriously, my sponsor was like, what do you do for fun? And I went, what is fun? And she looked at me like I was a foreign student or something, because she's like, I had literally had to make a list of what was fun, what I actually spend time, what I lose time in doing, what I wanted to do with my life, what, you know, all these things that I didn't know. And then she made me do them, and that was like, you know, killing me, because I had to stop what I was supposed to be doing, which was achieving and doing what I needed to do, and I had to go and do this thing that was supposed to be fun, and, you know, it did wind up working out for me. Here I am, you know, but at the time, it was like, what is fun? I don't understand it. So we have to write our own personal ad by getting to know who we are, and in that, and that's not just not on the surface, that's in every level of our life. What interests us? What do we not want to be a part of? What friends used to be, we really were in sync and we're not anymore. Doesn't mean we won't come back to that. Maybe we're just not anymore, you know? And we need to take a look at all these things. We have to narrow it down bit by bit for ourselves. We don't necessarily have to do it by ourselves, because we can ask other people. One of the practices in there where you had to ask your friends, the people closest to you, to give you one word about you. And I was shocked at the words I got back, because I didn't ever see myself as that kind of person. And then I had to meditate on those words for a while, because I was just like, how can these people see something that I can't see in the mirror? So getting to know ourselves, I had blocked even my own side of myself. So, and then we have to start taking steps in that direction. It sounds easy, and sometimes it is easy, and sometimes it's not. Every day, if we can get up with an attitude that today I'll make one small difference in my life. Say hello to my neighbor, like Jody was saying, right? Wave to a friend, call somebody you haven't talked to in a lot of years. Celebrate our mini wins. You know, if we get through the whole day and we've eaten less calories than we did the day before, that's a win for people that are overweight, right? For people that can't control that. Or if we get through our day with, smoking. One of the big things, one of my last things that I had to get rid of was smoking. And I know that you know this if you're in recovery, because it's like you hang on to that one, that's all I've got left is smoking, right? It's not hurting anybody else. It's only hurting myself. And I had to do it in a way, I had tried cold turkey 4 times and it didn't work. And I had to do it in a way where I narrowed it down and narrowed. Today I'll only smoke 10 cigarettes. Tomorrow will be 9. The next day will be 8. The next day I'll only have them at this time. The next day I can't have any in the car. I can't have any in the bedroom. Any little change, and celebrate it. Give yourself kudos. It's okay to say, yay, I did it. I made it that far. So, and our circle of friends can be our support. If we feel like we're not going to follow through on it, find an accountability partner. That's easy enough. Find somebody, say, hey, you know what? I'm trying to practice on working on this. I'm about myself. And I want you to see if you see something, lovingly call me back on it and ask me, hey, did we talk about this earlier? Were we going to do this a different way? And they'll go, oh, that's right. Because sometimes, even cursing can be like that, right? You see, that's why people put the little money jars on the table. So every time you curse, mom or dad's got to put money in the money jar. Teaches them that if they pay enough to those kids, they're going to stop or they're going to slow way down. So find a mindfulness practice. And mindfulness is so many different ways. And I'm not trying to in any way push my religion on anybody else, because that's just not who I am. Religion is about how we find ourselves to be. And so is our mindfulness. Some people have mindfulness practices of dancing. Some people hike. Some people sit in the lotus position and meditate. I can't even get into the lotus position. I'm sorry. I never could before. Maybe someday I will, but I never could before. I'm not going to make it now, right? So add a few things in that might help you bring down. There are apps for the phones and for the computers, little bells that ring that remind you to take a breath. Just take a breath and bring yourself back into here and now. And go, I am doing this to be my best self. Not to show anybody else that we can do it. Not to say, oh yeah, the praises of our boss, but because I'm trying to be my better self. Give ourselves the gift of releasing part of that or persons that no longer serve us. You know, that's a big one, and it's scary because sometimes we hold on to people, and I know this from being in CODA for a long time. We hold on to people because somebody's better than nobody. And I tell you that because that was my life, okay? I'd rather be hurt and have somebody than be alone and have nobody. And I am so grateful for the lessons that I learned that that's not true. I evolved, I became who I am, and I learned that I would rather be alone than have somebody that mistreated me. But it took me years to learn that. I wasn't modeled for me, and I didn't have somebody saying that I deserved better. So take it from me, take it from everybody that does this, you do deserve better. What will it do for you, right? It's immeasurable. The difference, from every level of our lives, it can change us. In the change happens through, before you know it, and sometimes, this is another thing too. Sometimes when I look back in that rearview mirror, because that's really the only thing, we're not really supposed to be cranking our heads and looking back, but the mirror is actually a really great device. So when I look in the mirror in the car and I'm driving, triggers me sometimes, I'm like, oh yeah, that is how far I've come. Not just on the road, but in my life. My life is so different than it was 25, 30 years ago when I was lost and I was alone and I felt, even in a crowded room, I felt like nobody understood me. I have people that understand me. I have people that get me now. I have people that can finish my sentences. I have people that go, oh, I know what you're thinking, because I'm in the company of me. I am myself and I'm in the company of me. Because that's all where it starts, right? With our little short list. It physically took weight off my shoulders. I feel like I carry less stress. And if you're in tune with your, if when people become in tune with their body at all, they start realizing there's different points, you know, there's different chakras and stuff. And when this all starts falling off, we spin differently. Our energy is different. That's because we're changing and we're evolving. We're not stuck in that same stuff anymore. It lowers stress. That's been proven. There's countless research papers on it. It creates better health to just jump into the change, be proactive in it. And it reduces my monkey brain because I can say, you know what, that was then. This is not now. And I keep turning it over to my higher power and saying, even when it comes in and creeps in or it's triggered by something else, I go, you know what, no, that was then. And you're right, I did make mistakes. And I'm so grateful for who I am now. Emotionally, I was able to forgive. And that was a big deal. A lot of us are wounded deeply. Some of us, myself included, even before words, I was able to form words, the wounds began. And to be able to sit in a place where I'm in my life where I can say, I made this. This is forgiveness. This is what it is. This is not mine. This is theirs. And to be able to, I finally was able to accept that I'm sorry from somebody else. And that was huge because it didn't, I thought for a while it was going to trigger me and it was going to send me into this worry about, oh, well, maybe I overstated it in my mind or, you know, but no, I realized I deserved that and it's okay. It took a lot of years for it to come. And in some cases, it's never come because the person has passed. And that's okay. And I'm okay with that because I know where my life is going. I know who I am. And emotionally, I'm more balanced. I feel better. I know my body better. I fear a lot less. Things will happen. Stuff will come up and people go, oh, no, we're in a panic. And I was like, you know what? I think it's going to be okay. I'm not sure how, but it's going to be okay. So that releasing that fear is a big deal for me, growing up in a very fear-based family. But I've been able to find peace in my mind and my heart, and I have a mindfulness practice, which is great. I'm not perfect. I'm a work in progress, and I probably will be saying that as I lay, I'm like taking my last breath. Keep going. It's a work in progress, right? So mentally, that peace of mind is worth every step I've taken in this direction. And if you can imagine that you can grow, you can. And everything is growth, right? We plant seeds. I'm a master gardener. We take a seed and we shove it into the dark, complete darkness, and it grows. It grows with the things that it needs coming to it. So if that seed is the natural order is growth, our natural order is growth as well. Oh, take this with you, okay? Change is part of life. We can go with it or we can go against it, which in my experience in going against it took me a lot longer to finally try to turn around and go with it, okay? Let's be proactive and have it work in our favor. Have it help us through what we need to be. And with this, times changing as fast as they are, do we really know 10 years from now what our lives are going to look like? But we do know that they're going to change. So in what way do we want them to change, right? Make the changes we want for ourselves and our lives. And watch for infinite possibilities. Right now, anything is possible. That's where change is born, is the fact that anything is possible, okay? Be the change you wish to see in your life. And start now. Let's pray. Father, Mother, God, we thank you for this time, for these words, for the hearts that it reached, and for the knowledge that change is constant. And we can have it with ease and grace in all we do in every way and every day. We thank you. Thank you, thank you. Amen.
Hi, my name is Linda B., and it is my privilege to present change as a spiritual principle, the principle in action. I was thinking about, you know, what do I say about change as a principle in action, and how do you develop spiritually? And it occurred to me that I'm standing in a church, so there is change in action. Using it as a spiritual principle, though, means having faith, embracing change instead of running away from it, starting to see change and to start change and to create change with the faith that whatever comes, whatever happens, you're going to be the right person to handle it. You're going to be the person called to be in whatever place you find yourself in. It can be really, really scary. It can also be really, really fun. And it's amazing how as you start to have faith in a higher power, you automatically start to have faith in yourself. And just like Becky said, you look back and it's hard to imagine how you got so far. You did it by embracing change, by embracing the spirituality of change. I have gotten to a point where most of the time I tell myself, instead of this too shall pass, that this too shall change. And knowing that truth has helped me endure and walk through a lot of things that were very difficult for me. But I knew that this is just right now, and everything changes. This too will change, and the best is yet to come. Thank you.
Doesn't last all morning. A cloudburst doesn't last all day. Seems my love is up and has left you with no warning. It's not always gonna be this great. Must pass away. Sunset doesn't last all evening. A mind can blow those clouds away. After all this, my is up and must be leaving. It's not always gonna be this great. All things must pass. All things must pass away. Face another day. Now the darkness only stays the night time. In the morning it will fade away. Daylight is good at arriving at the right time. It's not always must pass.
change. Let's hold on to this concept and take it into quiet contemplation and meditation. Accept God's love. Accept your higher power. Know, change is for you. Inhale the love, the energy, the air. Relax. Take this air down deep to the recesses of your lungs. And now exhale. Love is constant. Change is constant. A river flows. It ebbs. It recesses. It's there. But it is constantly changing. And we benefit from this constant change. Take in another deep breath. Feel the relaxation coming upon you. Let go of everything that doesn't serve you. Let go of everything that's holding you back. Do not fear change. Embrace it. We are perfect beings. Change makes us perfect beings. Our journey in life is a surprise. The changes that we expect are the changes that we need. Our higher power, Holy Spirit, God, manifests changes for us because of the love that we are given. Embrace the changes. Hold on to them with both hands. Be adventurous. You are better for everything that comes to you. We are better because of it. Take in another breath. Feel the energy. Feel the spirit. Feel the love. Feel how you have changed in the past couple of seconds. All is good. All is wonderful. Stretch your arms out. Touch the universe. Wiggle your hands. Wiggle your fingers, your toes. Smile. Open your eyes. Come back to the here and now. Knowing you are changed and you are thankful, grateful, and so happy for that opportunity. Be blessed. Be happy. Be joyful. You are a blessed change in the world, and we are thankful that you are. Namaste.
A lot of us grew up believing at any moment we could lose it all. And at the drop of a hat, God might turn his back and move on. A lot of us feel like we blew it, thinking that we're just too far gone. But I want you to know that there's still a hope for you now. And no matter what you've done, you can't erase his love. Nothing can change it. You're not separated, no matter what. There's never been a better time to get honest. There's never been a better time to get clean. So come as you are, run to the light and be free. Oh, be free. 'Cause no matter what you've done, you can't erase him. Nothing can change it. You're not separated. No matter where you run, he's always holding on. You're still a daughter, you're still a son, no matter what. You're still a daughter, you're still a son, no matter what.
Thank you, Jody. And as we bring this session to a close, thank you to everyone who participated and to you for attending. Thank you, thank you. And now, with the closing prayer, the prayer of St. Francis. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, It is pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is dying that we are born to eternal life. Thank you, and have a wonderful week.
Being in recovery means being of service. Locally, the Salvation Army is looking for food donations. The San Diego Blood Bank is looking for donations, and McAllister Thrift Store is also looking for donations of any kind. You don't know what you want to do or volunteer? Look at volunteermatch.com.
Join us in spreading our message of recovery. Send your donations to Unity Church of El Cajon, 311 Highland Avenue, El Cajon, California, 92020. Be sure to put in the memo, it's for a place of faith. You can donate online as well at unityofelcajon.org. There's a donate button. It's safe and secure.
We want to work with your organization. We have speakers with decades of experience. We do workshops, speaking engagements, spiritual mentoring, lessons, and more. Give us an email at aplaceoffaith@sohomail.com.
Stay connected and updated. We're on Facebook and YouTube. Like, share, comment, and subscribe.
A Place of Faith is sponsored by Unity Church of El Cajon.